Good morning. Good morning, brethren. This is a very, very wonderful day that the Lord has made for us. It's a very good morning. We thank God that the Lord has been gracious to us to offer us another day, a day that we can be able to rejoice and be glad in it. How wonderful it is to behold the mercies of God that are made new every morning, that every day God arises us with new mercies, that we can be able to enjoy the blessing on a new day. And specifically a day of Wednesday to us, a special day, a day that we always set apart for prayer, a day that we also accept to seek the face of God, and sometimes also prioritizing the spiritual issues and allowing the Spirit of God to overrule our human desires. And that's why we cause that day to be a day of prayer and fasting. And on a Wednesday and also Thursday in our parish, we call those days the days of prayer, the days of prayer and fasting. And we thank God that this day the Lord is unleashing his new mercies to us, that we may also seek him in truth and in spirit. I wish you, my brother, this day that will be a day that is full of grace, the grace of supplication and the grace of prayer. Let us pray together. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that you give to us. And now, Father, we usher ourselves into your presence, O God. And we know that you always have open hands to us. And by your grace, you always allow us through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that as we come to you this day to hear your word and also to devote ourselves in prayer and fasting in the entire day, that your presence will continue to be with us. Open the heavens for us, that our prayers may be heard by you. Open our spirit that we may understand the truth of your word, that we may also pray according to your word and within your will. And bless us as we meditate on your word, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Brethren, I want to thank God for you. Thank you for being there every day. And we thank God for the fellowship that we have had. Now, yesterday, we started a journey of continuing to learn now about the tenets of being able to lay down a firm spiritual foundation. A firm spiritual foundation. Remember the story that is told in the book of Matthew chapter 7 of that gentleman in the verses 24 and following, of that gentleman that was starting to build. And there were two people, and one was called wise, the other one was called foolish. One was able to put his house on a very firm foundation. He was able to dig, dirt his hand, do his work. He was able to be keen to make sure that he is putting his building and laying his building on a firm foundation. But this other guy who also did and used the same materials, but you know what he did? He was not very keen about the foundation that he was able to put his building on. And the Bible says that the winds came, the storm came, and the rain fell. And what happened is the building that was on a firm foundation was able to stand. But this other building was carried away. How many times we suffer the carrying away of our lives because of the storm, the carrying away of our families because of the storm, the carrying away of our very important things that we have worked for, built for many years, our destinies, our dynasties. Sometimes we have put so much on them, but because we laid them on the long foundation, you realize that in the trickling on an eye, we lose everything that we have worked for. But the Lord is reminding us at this particular time that as we continue to put our hands on the building of our spiritual house, that we also need to be careful about the foundation in which we lay our buildings. And that's why we started yesterday and we dealt with two of those important tenets. We remember we dealt with having fellowship with God, and importantly also having fellowship with other people in the body of Christ. Now today, I want us now to be able to deal with the second, the two remaining, which is being able to know the truth. And number two, we will be dealing about practicing that truth. Now, brethren, did you ever know that one of the declarations of Jesus Christ about the truth, he said that one of the things we need to know, that we shall know the truth and the truth will set us free. Now, setting us free from what? It will set us free from the works of sin, from the powers of darkness, and from the works of the enemy. You know what? When storms come of life, they either come through sin, through the power and the works of the enemy, or through our human nature, the desires of our flesh. And you remember, even our father, Adam, he was just tested within those areas, and he was able to fall. But Jesus came, and the devil used the same formula. But you remember, the temptation of Jesus, he was able to overcome all of them. He was able to overcome the desires of the flesh, he was able to overcome the pride of life, and he was also able to overcome even that which the enemy wanted, even the desire of the flesh, which is also exalted in when he is saying that make this stone to become bread. And every time, those are the storms You remember even what we were reading when we were starting about the book of Matthew and say, seek ye for the kingdom of God. It's also, it is preceded by the worries. And you know the worries about the worry about food, about dressing, about a good diet. And all those things are the things that worries us. And they are the things that chokes our growth in our spiritual walk. But may the Lord help us even this month to remember that when we know the truth of the word of God, we are able to stand. It becomes a strong weapon to destroy the works of the enemy. It becomes a strong weapon to fight the work of the flesh. It becomes a strong weapon to fight the pride of life. You know, when sometimes God blesses us, and then it's like we are full of ourselves. We are full of what God has caused us to acquire. And we forget that even what we have, it's not by our strength. It's not because of our experience. It's not because we came from good places. It's not because of anything that we can be able to boast about. It's just by the grace of God. But the enemy drifts us away from humility, and he causes a spirit of pride. And this morning, I want just to remind you some important things about the truth of the word of God. Did you know that in the book of John chapter 14, when Jesus' disciples were asking where he is going, and then he said, I am the truth. Jesus is the truth. And I am life. That eternal life we look for. And he is the way. In other words, we cannot stumble away. We cannot fall away if we make Jesus our priority. If we want to know the truth, we must hold Jesus and become the center of our lives. When we invite Jesus in our lives and become the center of our lives, one thing that we know, we have the truth that sets us free from every bondage. And also, it's good also to say that when we want to know that truth, then we must seek for it in a strategic way. I said this. Sometimes we are very good to prosper in other areas of life. We do very good physical development. We develop very well, even institutional, even as a church, we can be able to do magnificent building, physical development, perfect, but we fail on our spiritual growth. Do you know why we fail? It's because we don't have a strategic plan on how we learn the truth of God that solidifies our foundation, and therefore we can be able to grow and stand at all seasons. Now, number one, on how we grow on our spiritual foundation, especially knowing the truth, it is important to know that we need to have a strategic way on how we read the Bible. You know, it is good to read the Bible, but it's good to have a strategic way. How I can maybe ask, which book are you reading this month? Which Bible book are you reading to understand the word of God? Because the word of God is God. You know, Jesus, whom I say that should be the center, is the one who is the word of God. He says, in the beginning there is word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. And when he was manifested to the flesh, he was Jesus. Therefore, for us to be able to grow in the knowledge of God, we need also to have a strategic way on how we read the Bible. I am happy that there are people who read the Bible every year from Genesis to Revelation, but I also want to encourage us not only reading the Bible, but also it is good to strategically, in a way that we are able to read the Bible and do a Bible study of a book every month. It can help us to grow even in. It's also good to say that there are also some places that we can be able to engage with, like the TEE. That is the theological by extension. And this theological that we get by extension, TEE, is like it's something that has already been formulated. There is a curriculum on how you read strategically the word of God. And when you read the strategically, you can be able to quantify what have you done and what you have not done. The way we have been seeing in these devotions, you realize we have been dealing with different teachings so that we may be able to move from one level to another, that we can be able to understand where are we coming from, what have we been able to get, and all this stuff. It is important to be strategic. Allow me also to say, as we lead the word of God, we also need to lead some other materials that are help us to become tools of understanding the word of God. It is good also, as you do your Bible study, also to have maybe a concordance. It is also good to even look for other tools, even having another material that can help you to understand the revelation of the Word of God. I want to encourage you also, there are good books, spiritual books, that we need to read. Sometimes it's good every month you also choose, which book am I going to be reading? Like now we are talking about the Holy Spirit last month. You can choose and go and buy a book. You can buy, and sometimes we see as if it is very expensive to buy spiritual books, but we buy so many other things. For people even go for gym. They pay for gym. One month you pay for gym like 10,000 for gym. And amazingly, we see it is so expensive to buy a book, even 800 shillings or 1,000 shillings. It is good to buy a book in relation to the Holy Spirit. When you read that book, you can never remain where you are. You grow. But what you do as you choose these materials, it is good also to seek guidance, even from spiritual leadership, so that they can also guide you on the best books you can be able to lead, so that you can also lead on the light doctrine. Allow me also to say, it is important when we lead and understand the truth, we are set free. And we are, our foundation are stable. No matter now what storm that comes in our life, no matter what kind of a wind that comes on our life, one of the things that we are able to know, we're going to stand. Not because of who we are, because of the foundation in which we have laid our lives. We are human beings like any other. We can be challenged like any other person. Not because we are born again that we became other people. We are just men like any other man. But what makes us different? Jesus in our lives. Jesus being the center of our lives, our foundation. That's why when the storms come, the way we deal with temptation and difficulties, it's not the same. That's why Paul was very courageous, even talking about one of the strangers, the very difficult enemy of man, even death. And he said that even when we are believed, we don't mourn as people who do not know Christ. Can you imagine that even the storm of death, Jesus is able to help us, that even in the morning, we are able to mourn as men and women who have hope in life after death. And that's why we should solidify our lives on the truth and the truth of the word of God. And number two is practicing this truth. Do you know what the Bible says in the book of James? James encourages in a very amazing day and says that we should not only be hearers of the word, but we should be doers. And you remember he pulls up a very interesting thing. He says, now, faith without actions is dead. And he said, now, even when somebody visits you, like this time of COVID-19, someone comes to you and they are hungry. Now, do you just make prayer for them? Do you just tell them God bless you and he watch over you? He says that is not enough. Pray for them, yes, but give them food. That is what we call faith. And faith without action is dead. When men come to you and they are naked, you don't stop praying for them and are praying in tongues and raising your hand on them. No, you pray for them, yes, but you also cover their nakedness. That is what we call faith, because true faith has actions. And therefore, that's why we are encouraged that for us to solidify our faith, we must put our faith into action. I've learned every time I've ever grown in anything in life, and especially on spiritual standing, I must have made a decision, a deliberate decision, to do something about what I have believed. By the way, I've learned, if you want men to be healed, you must have faith to pray for them for healing. You cannot be fearful to lay your hand on a sick person and expect to see the manifestation of God healing. It doesn't work. You can only lay your hand and then you wait God manifestation. Therefore, faith without action is dead. I've also learned, by the way, it is not possible for you even to say that you are born again unless you confess. You can have faith, yes, the Bible says you are justified. But when you confess it, you are born again, or even you receive salvation. And therefore, salvation is not only by faith, but also by doing that which practice faith that we have practiced. And therefore, that's why we say we shall know the truth, but we must practice the truth. Allow me also to say in the book of Romans, chapter 12 and verses 2 and following, allow me to read that. It is important. Let me just read Romans chapter 12 and verses 2 and following. This is what the Bible says. Do not conform to the patterns of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Allow me to say this. The truth that we practice, there is something that it does. Any truth that does not transform, it is not the right truth. Any truth that you have, and it has not transformed your life, it is wanting in a praise. And you know, when we put our faith in practice, when we put the truth that we have known in practice, it brings transformation. Transformation of life. We find healing. We find God's deliverance from every bondage of sin, from habits. We cannot continue saying that we know Jesus is the truth that sets free, but we continue following patterns of habits that we have struggled with. We must make a decision of putting our faith and our trust and the truth of the word in practice. And that's why the Bible tells us that Paul was saying it brings the transformation. And when we are transformed in the renewing of our mind through the truth of the gospel, do you know what happened? We are able to know the perfect will of God that is pleasing and is perfect. And you know, if there is any desire we should have, brethren, is to have to do the will of God. Brethren, may the Lord bless you. Allow me to say, it is so important to continue to have a good foundation. May the Lord put you and put a tenet of foundation on your fellowship with God, fellowship with other men in the body of Jesus Christ, knowing the truth and also practicing the truth. And when we do this, brethren, we are going to grow from one level to another. Did you ever know that for us to grow tall, we must be willing to grow deep? In other words, there is no building that grows tall if it has not grown deep. Two things must be happen. As we want to grow up, we must grow deep in the Word of God. We must grow deep in our salvation. And then we'll be able to be a house that has been built in the wise and the wisdom of God that will be able to stand every storm. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord do you good in everything that you do, because He is willing that we may continue to grow up. Father, we thank you that even our spiritual growth is only you who can enable us. Even the grace to grow, the grace to know the truth, the grace to practice the truth, and the grace to go in fellowship with you and men can only be enabled with by you. We pray this day, dear God, that even as we sit down to continue praying and seeking your face, help us to grow in this truth, that we may be able to grow in our Christian walk and be able to stand all the storms of life. And bless us indeed, even as we fellowship with you, in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord do you good. May the Lord seek and keep you, even as we meet tomorrow with our brother Reverend Njuguna, even to move on to the next level of our spiritual growth, and we continue to move from one level of glory even to the other. God bless you so much.